somewhere along the way, I started thinking, you know, what would Bernard Herrmann with no money sound like? Big, orchestrally driven, slightly over the top. The audacity and the bombast. What does classic Hollywood mystery thriller sound like if you can get like a few people in a room? Hello, I'm Ben Lovett, and I composed the music for The Wolf of Snow Hollow. My entry point was focusing on the idea that you have this big problem in a small place, right? And everything's kind of through the perspective of this individual that tends to conflate these events and his own responsibility to them to a point where it starts to get sort of absurd. And what could we do musically that had a little bit of that absurdity in built into it?
Let me just make this perfectly clear. There is no such thing as werewolves.
Ben Lovett and I talked about the movie and talked about the kind of like big classical stuff that we really loved and the kind of like spooky brooding strings, and he was able to bring his whole team to make this incredible score, and he never told me no. There were moments where I was like, we should go like big Russian, like crazy full orchestra stuff, and he was like, we have a couple of players. We can't do that, but we'll do what we can. And you'd never know.
He sent me like a clip of like a 75 piece orchestra playing this Prokofiev piece from Romeo and Juliet. He was like that. And I was like, yeah, man, nah. But I'll try. I think I know what you want. I'll just try to figure out a way to get us there. I recorded the score at Echo Mountain Studios in Asheville, North Carolina, who have a great symphony orchestra and a lot of really talented players. We didn't have the resources to do something like those classic films, so what could we take from them and build into something that seemed appropriate for this one? Decrease our dynamic peaks early so that we have room to kind of lay into them a little more towards the back half.
What I really loved about the process of working with Ben was he was a collaborator and was just as energetic about the movie as I was. So when we were in the final mix for the movie, he would be bringing in stuff that he had done the night before, and we'd be laying it in and mixing all the different stems of different instruments. And he and I were both like standing up in the mix stage with all the speakers and just like, what if we do this? What if we do that? And it was such a fun, collaborative experience working with the dude.
I'm certainly not coming in there trying to be the brakes on the wheel. Jim had a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of energy for what we might be able to do. He really encouraged me to just kind of run with whatever my interpretation of his direction would be and see where we landed with it. For directors, it's such a circuitous path to get to that final stage where all the elements that you've been trying to put together for so many months are all in front of you. So I want to at least try to match the level of ambition of the person I'm collaborating with. Lovely. Say again?
R41.
41.
And that note, I don't think exists.
And why don't I put you in at 37 in that rest? Punch you in there.
He delivered in so many different ways, and the music, you can hear it. It's unbelievable. It's like this brooding, sad, alcoholic dad movie, and it's this scary monster movie at the same time, and you feel it. It's very nostalgic and serious and heavy and also awesome. Yeah, I love working with Ben. It was a great teamwork. He's the best, and the score shows that.
There's a real heart at the center of this. You're dressing up this human story in werewolf's clothes. There's so much subtlety, and there's so many just tiny little things to appreciate. I don't know, I wanted the score to contain that as well, and I felt like this thought experiment of a low-budge, classic Hollywood mystery thriller score was an opportunity to give the film a sonic personality, but also turns it just ever so slightly off-center and maybe gives it a bit of a characteristic that you might not expect.